Welcome to Apex Yoga. Welcome to Apex Yoga. Apex Yoga, very simply, is the mainstream transmission of Longchenpa and his apex array, the vast apex array of Longchenpa, the omniscient Dharma King, the great Tibetan guru Dharma King. And it's come down throughout history, this term Dzogchen sometimes. This seems to be somewhat Dzogchenist, but it's really apex yoga. So a little more to it than just straight Dzogchen, actually. And what we say here is that all we're doing with conditioned existence, what is conditioned existence, the ocean of samsara, what is that really? We're hallucinating the absence of reality. That's all we're doing. We're really, the viewpoint that we have when we look out and see the universe, it's an hallucination of the absence of God that we're perceiving. But it's a hallucination. Perception is hallucination, actually. And the fact is that all we have to do, the apex approach, all we do is let go of that hallucination. That's it. Nothing more needs to be done. However, we're so used to hallucinating the absence of God, we have great insecurities in letting go of it. Great insecurities. And so we have to be very careful, cautious, and it requires steady determination and skillful means to drop this hallucination. And when we drop it, ultimately, we see that that all is saturated with the peace of God, everything, without exception. So we can never see the peace of God, experience it, if we're trying to make an exception, say, well, it rests, everyone's saturated except this bad person, then you won't see it because you're hallucinating the absence of it. God is totality, is certainty, totality. If we see it as fragmented, we don't see it at all. And then we're just playing games of labels is all we're doing. The ocean of samsara is really just a play of labels. And we're just throwing all these labels around. It's kind of like we're arguing over how should we label nothing? You know, how should we label hallucination of the absence of God? What should we label that as? It's absurd to play this game, isn't it? What sort of label shall? How should we label zero? How should we label nothing? How about just releasing all labels equally, simultaneously, just as they are? I don't know what I'm going to do. Maybe I'll showcase the recognition of the peace of God. Maybe just showcase that to people. I don't know. Maybe I'll be better at that. I don't really feel like I'm a good teacher at all, in terms of relating with other people. I really don't. I'm not like a parochial vicar, who's. Some are really talented at that, and others are talented in different ways. Maybe some are really good at showcasing it. I'm a Leo, so maybe I'm good at that. I don't know, but we'll see. Is this video even recording? It's really amazing how it's not working so well anymore. But I don't know what to make of it. Pretty astonishing. At any rate, it's very simple. But our insecurities with letting go of this, hallucinating the absence of God, our insecurities are extreme. And so those crop up, and what happens is they try to devise some combination, some fragmentation that's okay, and label it, this is God, but it's fragmented. And all sorts of distortions, all sorts of theological distortions everywhere. This is just our insecurities. Continuity fear, I call it. We're afraid to let go of hallucinating the absence of reality, because we're trying to convince ourselves the hallucination is true. And so if the hallucination that reality is absent is true, when we let go of it, we obviously have to infer that there's an abyss. You know, it's a complete abyss annihilation. Fortunately, hallucination of the absence of what is real doesn't affect what is real at all. Fortunately, it has no power over God. Hallucination has no power over God at all. Fortunately, otherwise we really would have to keep doubling down on hallucination. Now, can we ever feel secure with hallucination? We're trying to. We're trying to. The world keeps trying to double down on it. Double down says, no, we just got to have more doubt, more doubt, more doubt, more hallucination of the absence of God. And try to make it steady, secure, stable, trying to stabilize it. But the truth is that we're all, in each instant, we're only one instant away from dropping this hallucination. Because hallucination never leaves its source. Just like we're an idea in the mind of God and we never leave that source of God, hallucinations never leave their source, which is our mind. So they're always subject to the power of the mind. There's no dynamic at all, present at all in hallucination, except just directly the power of the mind, desiring to do so, interested in doing so. There's no other dynamic at all, none. So there's nothing to stop us from dropping the hallucination instantly. And so it's impossible to feel secure in hallucination. The future can never be secured, so to speak. We can't feel like, oh, you know, for sure I'm going to keep on doing this in the future. No, because we're totally free to drop it at any instant. That's the power we have, and we can't do anything about that power. But on the other hand, we also have the power to keep it as long as we want, right? So don't be afraid that it somehow will depart you. If it does and you get frightened, you'll bring it right back. They bring it right back instantly. So really, we shouldn't be that afraid, because we can keep it as long as we want. We're so used to doing it; it's easy for us. It almost feels automatic. We're trying to automate it, actually, but that can never happen, right? Because again, at any instant, we can simply stop hallucinating, plain and simple. We'll always be that way. So never, never, never can we concretize it and solidify it and stabilize it and rest assured that that is so. If we think that trying to make hallucination permanent, that's our goal, we'll always feel unstable, very unstable. There'll be this dread within us, this fear of there's some instability lurking somewhere, and then we project that out on others and say, there, you know, the boogeyman's out there. That's where the instability is, not within me. And we try to use projection and guilt and project it out, project the guilt on someone else. The responsibility is yours. You're making me feel unstable, and that's what makes the world go round here. Hallucination is never secure in the next moment. Only if we want it to appear in the next moment, it will. If we don't, it won't. In other words, there's no dynamic that can secure it, and we think the world is some sort of has some sort of dynamic can secure it. No, the world itself, or at least our viewpoint on it, is hallucination. A hallucination can't be causative of anything. It cannot stabilize itself. It cannot. So we're perpetually insecure when we're hallucinating. This now. So what we do on the path, we're so insecure about this that we get hassled by our insecurities along the path. But that's okay, because we can still continue by being hassled. What we don't want to happen is to be tormented by our insecurities. If we're tormented by our insecurities, then things get really difficult, and we stall out. We stall out and accept some nonsense that we hope will stabilize our hallucinating. And that happens all the time. Temporarily, but it can happen for a lifetime. You know, it really can. Most are stalled out in the world right now. Most are stalled out because the torment was too much. But so, in order to avoid torment, one needs to use skillful means. Really has to use faith, the grace of God, understanding synchronicity, understanding miracles, prayer, and understanding our insecurities, continuity, fear, bias of familiarity against certainty, against reality, all those biases and insecurities, they slow us down. They slow us down. They're always trying to, say, wait a minute, let's double down on hallucinating. Let's double down on it. That seems safer. And so it's always a struggle to keep going to reach the goal that we must all reach. Drop the hallucination of the absence of God. You have to drop that. Let it go. Stop doing it. And then what is there stands revealed. And again, it's not a blessing upon any particular person. It's the one who does this sees that blessing rests equally everywhere. Everything is saturated in God. There's no question of being blessed or not blessed. God's everywhere. God is everything. So how could we not be blessed? There's no such thing as not being blessed. So they just realize this. But people think, oh, someone, God has specially blessed them. They're special to God. Nothing could be further from the truth. That's a very much of a misunderstanding to say that someone is special. Even Jesus is not special. Not at all. God is equally everywhere. Everything is saturated as God. No one has more, no one has less of God. Okay? So this is the apex approach. And it's very just direct and simple and easy to understand, which is scary for a lot because they're afraid of dropping hallucinations, so they don't want the explanations to be too clear. They want it to be kind of confusing. So they'll raise questions like, "Ah, I have a question." What Lee says, "Ah, I really want to. I want to see if I can confuse this. It's getting too clear for me." That's really what questions are. People get nervous. They say, "Oh my gosh, it's so simple. I could drop it right now. Yeah, I see that." So, "Oh my gosh, that's scary." But again, if you drop it, you can pick it up instantly also. So it's worth hanging in there, and not trying to confuse the issue with questions, and answers and all that stuff, which is just labels, actually. It's just labels. Cloudy evening here, but it was a beautiful, gorgeous, warm spring day here in California. They say we're going to continue this way for about the next 8 days. Just, fabulous weather. And yeah, why not? But it's a shock, like we're into spring. I think we spring forward this weekend with our clocks. And are we ready for it? Are we ready for it? Well, I'm under tremendous pressure. So I'm having, troubles just I'm sort of staggering forward. I need to, be in abidance soon, really. I'm really going for it. It's coming. It's coming. So, and it may not be my job to answer any questions. I just showcase it without answering any questions. Just showcase it. So these people, we can all say, "Oh, okay, it's possible, but how? Why am I, missing it?" And it's you can't really answer that question because it's just insecurities. It's familiarity. That's the why of it. That's the why of it. But that gets too close to home too, because we say, "Oh, gee, that means I can really." There isn't any dynamic holding me back, which is true. And so we all want to think there's some dynamic from God or from somewhere that's somehow holding us back, and there isn't any such dynamic. Familiarity isn't really a causative dynamic. It's just that we're used to it, and we just imagine, we think, "Oh, this is easier to believe it this way because I'm used to it." Doesn't mean it's better or anything. It's just that we tend to cling to what we're used to in fear. So, familiarity is really the issue we have to work on, and that requires a lot of determination because we have to push through our expectations and get familiar with a new set of expectations, and that produces jitters because we realize there's nothing holding hallucination in place at all. We assume this world is holding it in place. It's not. You see, the reason why we love this world so much, we say that, is because we think it's holding our hallucination of the absence of reality in place. That it's holding it in place, that the world has some sort of dynamics that hold it in place. This is totally untrue. There's no such dynamic at all. Maybe we're disappointed in the world now. Right? I thought, and maybe we'll seek some other world at facet, but the same with that world too. So we might as well not waste time that way. It's recording. Who knows when this will stop? It's very erratic. I've tried everything, but that's okay. I'm trying to make the videos a little shorter, so make it easier for you to get through them. Right now, when you're going, just going as fast as possible, under tremendous stress, sleep deprivation, crisis in every which way, actually, in my life. Things can get a little ragged, but that doesn't mean you have to stop. I mean, I know I'm not on the top of my game right at this point, but that's okay. Just, keep trying to make pars. If you're making bogeys, then make a bogey. No, just don't make a double bogey. Just keep managing things as best you can. That's what it's all really about right now. So don't expect that you're going to be just on the top of your game at this moment. Maybe very few of us are. I talked to a friend today. I said, "How's the week going?" He says, "Well, how's it going?" He said, "I didn't even show up yesterday." I said, "Why?" He said, "I felt horrible. I got up. I felt just wiped out." I said, "What? That's amazing, because I felt exactly the same way. I could hardly get out of bed. I could hardly walk. I could hardly talk. I felt like a 100-year-old. I was like almost dead." But I still went to work, worked a full day, very tough day. But he said, "I couldn't even go to work. I just stayed home. I was so wiped out." And he says, "But I feel better today." Me too, I feel better. And someone else told me the day before that he just felt like absolutely horrible. Just and then again today, the next day, I met someone who told me, he just feels like, he just wants to die. He feels so terrible. I said, "Don't worry, I felt the same way yesterday. I feel a lot better today." He says, "Oh, that's good to hear." So some people picked me up from that, yesterday. And so it's important, if you feel good, to radiate that to others, because you never know. It might be somebody having a really bad day, like I did yesterday, and I needed somebody just to reassure me that, hey, I still have friends, and you're going to get through this, everything's going to be okay, and you're okay with us. And give some good positive advice, super positive advice, and say that, Apex Yoga is in the house. Don't worry. Apex Yoga is in the house. I mean, Longchenpa is in the house. We need to hear this. Longchenpa is in the house, meaning he's got his full attention on our situation. He's not off in some pure land. I mean, he's has his attention right here on you and me and everyone, I mean, he is dialed in to it. And he's probably not the only one. He's really dialed in. So why should we worry? Why should we worry? But that doesn't mean we're not going to be hassled by our insecurities and unsteadiness and familiarity bias. Of course, we will be. And I don't know, it was a combination for me. I don't know, it was everything. Severe sleep deprivation, just super tremendous breakthroughs that left my whole nerves just shaking. And then I had to pull a bunch of weeds, bending over, bending over, bending. And I'm not used to that. And I just could, felt like I was almost like a corpse. I couldn't move. Today I'm moving fine. Everything's good. I'm still working out. Now I'm doing bending exercises because I said, "Oh my gosh, I'm really out of shape that way." So I bend over and grab something heavy, and then straighten up, bend over to the ground and straighten up. And that, it gets a different type of muscular engagement that we try to, I see, I notice we try to avoid the repetitive, the exercise, the stuff we do in life that is difficult, wears us out. We try to avoid that in our workouts. But actually, it'd probably be a good idea to actually do just those things. Getting up from sitting on the ground, like getting up or getting off your knees quickly, or bending over and pick something up, bending over, pick it up, bending over, pick it up. If you need to pick up something, like bend over and pick it up 20 times or something like that. It's this little easy thing you can do. And I actually have been doing some of that today. And I'm trying to, if I see a thing on the ground I need to pick up, I bend over and pick it up. So bending over and picking stuff up is really important. And I had to go to take some of the doctor today in the doctor's office, and there's this really great book there. I can't remember the name exactly. And there's Doctor Something. I'll look it up. I'll see if I can find it on Google. And I was reading stuff, and I had this amazing information in it, like that I needed to hear. And tremendous exercises. It was a running a book on running, how to really be an optimal runner. Really, like a very thorough, wonderful book, talking about engaging the core and the hip flexibility in your hips and ankles, and how to treat hot spots when they occur. It super informative. And talking about water, when you drink a lot of water, you add a pinch of iodized salt to it because it helps the body absorb it. If you just drink straight water, like this is distilled water, it's not that helpful for you, actually. The body isn't able to absorb it as well. It doesn't put a pinch of iodized salt in it. So I should have tried it with this. I'm gonna try that. He has a lot of very good suggestions, and he really knows what he's talking about. So I was able to spend time reading that, waiting. Because that was a blessing right there, grace of God, because I needed to hear some of this stuff. I realized there are ways that I can stretch and keep, loosening up the body, and maybe treat, trouble with my knee in a better fashion. He said, don't ice it. Icing is not good. Well, I've been icing it a lot. It does kill the pain. He said something very interesting. He says icing came into vogue in the National Football League, the NFL, because it was super cheap. And so when the athletes got banged up, which in football, of course, you're constantly getting banged up, they just put ice on it, put an ice pack, wrap it up. And what happens, it freezes the area, kills the pain. Now, these days they have this in a spray can, the stuff that gets really cold. They just spray the area and just freeze it, and then the pain goes away. Plus they pop, ibuprofen or various stuff, painkillers. But he said it's not good for healing at all. Of course, the football is notorious for, putting people on the junk heap, the junk pile, the junk pile. I mean, they use the body to bodies up. So he said, don't ice. That's not good at all. Don't ice. I said, wow, that's interesting. But we can continue. I think just doing anyway, I'm trying to stay, within a certain amount of fitness work, and so far I am. You're always just one step away from slipping out of it. This is what I find in the spiritual path, the same way. You're always just one bad decision from going sideways. Really, it's really quite difficult because you keep having to keep make the right decisions. Say, no, I'll keep working on this, and don't lose your temper. I've almost lost my temper today. I'm so frustrated. I said, look, because there's so much bad situations piling up on my head. I said, we got to get this done, whatever it is we're going to do. And just tremendous constellations of indicators to me that great stuff is coming. But I said, well, yeah, but when? And I've always had some of that, so to speak. You're going to Hawaii. You're going to Hawaii. You're going to Hawaii. Everybody's going to Hawaii. Everything says going to Hawaii. It's just like bizarre. And I say, I don't even want to go to Hawaii. I don't really want to go anywhere. I don't really want to go to Hawaii. I don't feel like traveling really. But going to Maui. Going to Maui. You're going to what? I say what? It's not really, it's not feasible. But anyway, there's all these indicators. What does it mean going to Hawaii? Well, maybe it's like seeing the presence of God, feeling the presence of God everywhere. This beautiful, peaceful feeling. Hawaii, of course, is known for that. I was watching a video yesterday from people at the pipeline and the Billabong house, right, hanging out there. You can even see the pipeline waves, and they're just chatting. They're in Hawaii, and of course they said, but it's unbelievably expensive to live there. You go get a couple sandwiches, a couple drinks, it's $40. I mean, everything is just, it's most expensive state in the country by far. It's triple the expense of the least expensive state in the country. Triple, triple. The amount of hours you need to work to live there is it's crazy. So, I don't know. And somebody just got back from Hawaii and told me, he said, it is so expensive there. He said, I probably spent $1,500 on food or something. It's just on a vacation. It just, if you eat out there, you get hammered. So I said, I don't know. I mean, am I going to Hawaii? It's like pretty unlikely, super unlikely. So why is Hawaii keep coming up? This must be metaphoric for something, for a state of mind, for a state of mind where everything is, just the ambience is just beautiful. Just beautiful ambience, just hanging out in that ambience. Okay, hold on a second here. Full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow is very important. So when you get down, when we get down, which I've been down today, is rough. It's rough. It's a bumpy road, and you can't lose your temper. You cannot lose your faith or temper, but you're tempted to. So you have to be patient. And this just comes from faith and experience. And you just say, wow, it's somehow something. The path will continue for me. It will keep unfolding properly. Aunt Jemima's in the house. He's got it under control. Everything will work out great. I'll either be in Hawaii or be in the Hawaii state of mind. No troubles, right? It seems, amazingly unlikely at this point, and yet I have faith that it will be so. So I don't lose my poise. I don't lose my mental poise. It tries to get away, but it just doesn't get away from me very much anymore. Because so many reassurances arrive, so many reassurances rise that wow, there's going to be this amazing turnaround, amazing turnaround. Now, when we have this faith that there is a goal, that the peace of God is available for us, it's available for everyone, actually. It's available for everyone, and the problem for everyone is they're hallucinating the absence of it. That's it. There's no other problem that anyone has in terms that they have, of course, the insecurities about dropping the hallucination. That's the problem. But what's causing our trouble is just simply we're hallucinating the absence of God. And that's it for same for everyone. Everyone. So nobody is in any dire situation, actually, bad situation. The remedy is exactly the same for everyone. So there's no reason to feel sorry for anyone. Like somehow you have the right stuff, but they don't intrinsically don't. That's completely not true. Totally not true. And the fatigue is hitting me a little bit. Just the stress. The days are so stressful, and getting pulled from every direction. So of course I get a little tired. Absolutely. And the mind kind of sags a little bit, temporarily sags. But so the way to practice is to practice like, wow, I've got it. Wow, I've got it. The fear is to let go of it. And I was blind, but now I see. So we need to keep reasserting, since we know there's a goal, well, since we know there's a goal, we know it's there, we know it's reachable, it's just that we have these insecurities, then we stop turning to bodies for happiness, okay? We stop turning to a special relationship for happiness. We would say, no, I've got the peace of God. I can rely upon that. And that's real happiness. The other here is just actually torment. Relationships in this world between personalities and bodies is nothing but torment. It's just torment. That's all it is. And I noticed that, like, today I'm driving along and something tries to enter my attention. And I say, that's torment. I don't need that. I don't need torment. I know I can get the peace of God. I'll keep banking on that I'm going to reach. So I'm not going to let that even enter my mind. I have the peace of God is mine. You know, the peace of God is mine. That rests upon everyone equally. And this then helps pull us away. Our faith pulls us away from potential torment, which is everywhere. I mean, the most everyone here in the world is trying to keep their hallucination and find a way to be happy with bodies, believing that they're bodies, that they're people, actual persons and people and bodies. That's not true. And trying to find happiness that way, they're trying to secure their hallucination, make it secure. And as we said earlier, it's impossible to make hallucinations. It's always completely vulnerable to our decision to drop it the next moment. That never changes. We have total power to drop hallucination any moment, and we can not change that in the slightest bit. So we can never have the sense of invulnerability, feel that our hallucination's invulnerable. No matter who we get as a partner, a special relationship, it doesn't affect that at all. And eventually we see that, realize, I still feel insecure, and then we go on to the next one, or we start hating them or blaming them or something. It's horrible. It's horrible, isn't it? I mean, the whole dance of relationships in this world is absolutely horrible. We keep thinking that someone can make us feel invulnerable. Make us feel invulnerable to dropping hallucination. Totally impossible. So we're asking one another to do the impossible for each other. So we need to back away from that. Really need to back away from that. Stop believing that someone else can secure you, make you feel invulnerable, as long as you're holding on to your hallucination, hallucinating the absence of reality. That's always going to feel totally vulnerable. Always. Always. No way around it for anyone. So I'm not especially relationships, like, wow, stay away. I am not interested. Less and less and less and less and less and less. And those who are interested in that, they lack faith in God. You know, they lack faith severely, and they're not going to find it the way they're trying looking for it. So peace of God needs to be showcased in the world, and we need to put it in the right context. Of course, people will put it in the wrong context. They'll say, oh, again, here's someone special. God bless them specially, but God won't bless me. Yeah, like I think what they're saying is, I hope God doesn't take away my hallucination. That really scares me. And God cannot take away our hallucination. We're free. We're free. We're free. God made us free. He cannot infringe upon our freedom. And so we're free to hallucinate the absence of God. God cannot stop us from that at all. God certainly knows that we want to stop it, so we have the Holy Spirit, the grace of God, that reflects our desire to stop it, okay? It's really just ourselves, our own desire to stop it, but because of the freedom we have, we're free to experience that grace, to helps us move towards, you know, getting familiar with the more towards the peace of God, and therefore losing interest in the dance of doubt, the hallucination of the absence of reality. You know, we're doubting that reality is present because we're hallucinating its absence. I don't see it. You see it? No, I don't see it. Nobody here seems to see it. You come into the world, you see it, and everybody thinks you're crazy. So what do you talk about? Nobody else sees it. You must be crazy. You know, it's like coming into an insane asylum as a therapist, and everyone in the same time says, you're the crazy one, not us. And Yeah, that's what happens, right? That's really what happens here. And happening more and more, more and more and more and more. The whole conspiracy is going on in the world. It really is a conspiracy to get rid of all therapists so that we can claim, well, if there's no therapists, we must, everything must be fine. We won't, can't have any trouble. But if there's a therapist that's saying, you know, you need help and I'm here to help you, and then you can see a difference, then people get jittery and say, wait a minute, maybe I really do need some help here. Whereas if they think, well, there's no therapists anywhere, they can say, ah, we're fine. We're fine. We don't need any help. That's, you know, an insane solution. Doubling down on insanity. But that's what's happening here. That's what's happening here in the world. And anyone who tries to help out in the world is under relentless pressure to go in that direction, like to say, no, you don't need any help, you don't need any encouragement, and you're fine just the way you are in terms of your mental state. It's just a little problem or something. Now we have a severe problem, which is familiarity bias and tremendous insecurity about letting go of hallucinating the absence of God. Tremendous insecurity about it. We think it's an abyss. Because right, if we're hallucinating the absence of God, and we've done everything we can do to believe it's true, then we really have believed our own marketing, and we really believe that if we let go of this hallucinating the absence of God, there's nothing there. As I said earlier in the video, we think there's going to be nothing there, total abyss. So that creates tremendous jitters in us, doesn't it? So we have a really severe problem. But that's the only problem there is. Because stop hallucinating the absence of God, and you'll see God's present everywhere, and then it's our whole, you know, we don't need thoughts anymore. We don't, everything's smoothed out. Like, I'm experiencing. I don't need to think about how to preserve this hallucination of his absence. You know, there's nothing to preserve. It's self-preserving. Reality's self-preserving. It's always preserved. Don't need to take a thought for it at all. I should probably rest like for 2 weeks, just sleep, eat protein, good protein, or help repair the body, and just sleep. Then I'd probably feel better. But you know, what could you do? You have to get up in the morning, right? Yeah, sometimes it's not easy, is it? That is for sure. I had a ridiculous time yesterday. I can't remember. It's been a long time since I felt that. Ah, wow. Almost felt immobile. I said, how is that possible? I've been working out now for a year and a half and I feel completely immobile? You know, it's kind of shocking, isn't it? But this can happen. Spiritual path, same way. You're working so much on your, you know, familiarity bias and your insecurities about letting, you know, gently setting down the hallucination of the absence of reality, and we think that, oh, I should be really going great, and then you have days where you just feel so stupid, and you just can't even remember what you've been doing your whole life. Really, it's like that. You forget all about the spiritual goal, spiritual path, all this, and you just think, slips your mind, and then you say, what have I done? What am I doing? What have I done in my life? Have I done anything? And then doubt starts creeping in, right? Doubt starts creeping in easily that way. Of course, one might say that I have done nothing because there's nothing I can do. As far as the world goes, the world is a solution in search of a problem. There's no problem. There's nothing to apply the world to. There's no problem to apply it to. It's not causing any problem. It's not hallucinating the absence of God doesn't cause the absence of God at all. So what have we done here in this world? Nothing. What have we accomplished? We haven't accomplished anything. Nothing needs to be accomplished. Well, spring will be busting out here more and more and more as we go forward. No question about it. Moving through like a third of March pretty much by now. And before you know it, you've marched through March. And then April is just like full blast. And then we move into the warmer months. May, June, July, August, September, October, like that. Like May, June, July, October. 6 months. 6 months of the warm period. So we're, you know, zooming in that direction quite quickly right now. Which seems to be a different mindset, right? You survived the winter. Now you have to make the most of the summer hours. And but how, what's going to happen in the world? I don't know. I don't know. I don't even know what's going to happen with me. Going to Hawaii? Going back to Hawaii? I was lying on the bed and there was just, I said, what was this? I felt something. And I was on my back. I was lying, my back was lying on this letter opener, and there's this letter opener, and on the handle it had a beautiful picture of palm trees and diamond headers, and it said Hawaii. I said, where'd that come from? I don't know. And so it's like you're going back to Hawaii. You know, your back, it's on your back, Hawaii. Back to Hawaii. And it keeps coming up. Of course, I equate Hawaii with a beautiful state of mind because I was there. I lived there back in 1958 through 1960. And it was, you know, when I was really young, and it was like a paradise. I just loved it. It was so beautiful. I just thought everywhere is like this in the world. You know, rainbows, soft, warm, gentle rain. Just walking around in barefoot and shorts and just looking at all the leaves and the little bugs and you know, having the leaves, put them on little streams and have them float down. Then you can go down to the ocean and just watch the ocean and play in the ocean and collect beautiful shells. And, you know, I thought the whole world was this way. It was like Hawaii. But then we moved back to California. And I said, oh my gosh, this isn't Hawaii. This is terrible. I hated California. I still, you know, don't like it. I liked Hawaii a lot better. When I was young, now, you know, it's a small place, insular place, right? And maybe that wouldn't have been my cup of tea forever. But boy, I just suffered in California, especially the winters. I just said, it's never like this in Hawaii. You know, it's terrible. What's going on? It's freezing. It's just, I just felt like we were, you know, in Siberia or something. It's a lot easier to move to Hawaii than to move from Hawaii to somewhere else. Okay, that's a lot. That's rough. Once you get used to it, well, you don't wanna live somewhere else, really. No way. So I could probably get used to it again. But again, you know, I don't really, I'm not holding out any hope of that really happening. I just, it's more like likely a mental state that I'm going to be in, which is similar to the state I was in when I was there when I was two years old. Just really feeling the presence of God everywhere. Not worried about labels. Nobody said, well, this is this label, you know. God has a, as if this is somehow separate. And different saturation. Everything has different level, degrees of saturation. There's different words, you know, and different, all this differentiation in the concretized mind, so to speak, the concretizing everything. No, I was just like everything with these beautiful colors and shapes and forms, and it was just like a beautiful three-dimensional painting. Or I mean, it was just a living paradise, kind of. Just everything looked beautiful. and shining, and before again any schooling had taken place. So you know, that's the state of mind when it seems to be in the peace of God. I experienced some of that several days ago. I think it was this Monday, so it was like about, you know, 3-4 days ago. The awareness just stays diffuse. You're not fixated on anything like, oh, there's more of God there. Let me go towards this. So you lose that goal orientation of let me acquire this. Let me move towards this. This has more than this. That's not there. Everything is equally beautiful and pleasant and wonderful. And you don't feel like you got to grab a hold of something and acquire it. So when Longchampa says, you know, you drop, you know, no more goal fixation, nothing to reach, that's what he's getting at, is you don't feel like anything's deficient. There's no deficiency to address. There's no deficiency to address in any way. We can put it that way. Now, I'm a bit of a, you know, I like to clarify and get things said in the right way. It's my habit from a previous life as a composer, a musical composer, where, you know, I had to make the score. I did very, very complex scores, massive complex scores. And I had to make sure every note was right. And every, you know, the timing on every note was proper. And the timing on all the rests were proper. And, you know, so I'd go over and over and over the scores, you know, so many, many times, just smoothing it out, smoothing it out, smoothing it out, smoothing it out, smoothing it out. I held on to some compositions like for 10 years or maybe 15 years or so. And going back to it and addressing it again, you know, in a year and smoothing it out more, smoothing it out more. So that's my tendency is, you know, how to get it just right. How to smooth it out so it really flows properly. This comes from, you know, history of music and composition. And, you know, I had the orchestras playing it in music, and, you know, they're really expert musicians. And you know, if you don't have their parts correct, you know, they're going to know it. So I had to know everybody's parts, you know, and how to score it. And it's very difficult. All the instruments of an orchestra, and be able to write, you know, music for all those instruments. You have to be able to look at different sensibilities, different approaches. That's why I'm sort of very ecumenical in my approach to the spiritual path. I be able to look at things from a Christian perspective, from a Buddhist, from a Hindu perspective, from, you know, different perspectives, really. Jewish perspective to some extent, you know, just I always trying to say, okay, there's different parts of the orchestra here, and, you know, how what can be helpful for them? How should I say it to them? How can I write the score that, you know, they can follow and make beautiful music? So that's why I keep making these videos. I keep smoothing it out, you know, better and better and better and better and better and better. That's my habit. Should I add a, you know, harmony here, a third or a fifth or a second, or should I, you know, do a slip note between these two, or, you know, a little adagio, you like this, or what's the tempo here, you know, so, you know, fiddling with the tempo of the whole musical composition, the whole mood of it, what's the mood you want to create, and, you know, it's very involved. Music can become very involved. And it's all-consuming, actually. And, of course, you're trying to simulate the presence of God, the peace of God, in some way. At least I was. I was trying to see if music could be a way to help tune people into it. And ultimately, it really wasn't. It really wasn't. You really have to go in the way of clarification, actually. And skillful means. You know, bhakti, for instance, I understand bhakti. A lot of those who, Sri Srinarayana is used as a bhakti guru for many. And it's the same practice as like Rama Maharshi says, who am I? Use one thought to block all others. Well, in bhakti, use one person, so to speak, that you really love to block special relationships all other special relationships. Use one relationship to block all others. So that's a totally valid approach. And it'll work if you do that, just as much as using one thought, like I am an apex yogin. Wow. Just blocking everything else. So it's a very valid approach. Japa, mantra yoga, japa yoga, bhakti yoga, all these yogas are valid if done properly. For sure they are. Just put all your love on Sri Sri Narayana. That's it. Just keep it there. All your adoration, all your love, everything. Just keep it there, 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 there. It's bhakti. And then everything else settles down. The whole play of doubt settles down. And liberates you. Get liberated from the whole. You're able to drop the hallucination at some point. So I'm aware of these different approaches to some extent. And sympathetic to them. But again, you get what you get out of it, what you put into it. And most, you know, come up short. They really do. They keep thinking that they can use someone to stabilize hallucination. They think they can use Sri Sri Narayana to stabilize hallucination. Not possible. It is not possible in any way. That's why they tried to tell her that. She said, I'm nobody's guru. In other words, I'm nobody that can stabilize hallucination for you. Because it's your own power of your mind, which is all powerful. And there's not one of us can prevent somebody from hallucinating, or we can't force them to drop it, and we certainly can't stabilize it. It's impossible. So she can't stabilize it. Jesus can't stabilize hallucination for us. It's impossible. Again, every instant we can decide that we're going to drop it, and then instantly it's dropped. Or we can decide to pick it up again. Instantly it's picked up again. So we have total power over that, and nothing else has power over it. That's the same for everyone. So we're all got this insecurity because of that. And we're hoping to be able to change this, and we can't. We absolutely cannot change this. So what keeps us going on and on and on to the swamp of insecurity is we keep believing we can change that. We can change it. We can change it. We can change it. We can change it. We look for teachers that at least they kind of leave the door open a little bit, like, yeah, well, you know, maybe you can change it a little bit. You cannot. You can't change it at all. Not at all. Not even a tiny bit. Not even a tiny bit. We have absolute power over whether we hallucinate or not. Absolute power over that. And nothing else has. There's nothing else that has power over it at all. It's impossible. Body doesn't have power over it. The world doesn't have power over it. The universe doesn't have power over it. Nothing does. Not even God has power over it. God can't force us to stop hallucinating. Cannot. Cannot. So all these prayers to God, 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 you know, they're really praying to solidify hallucination, to hold it, to God, to permanently hold it in place permanently for us, which is part of the distortion of Christianity is the belief that God somehow agreed to permanently hold hallucination in place for us, and that would be our peace. We'd finally have peace of mind because of that. This is a delusion. Even God cannot do that. Even God cannot do that because we're an idea in the mind of God as an extension of God. God became us as perfect freedom. So God cannot change itself, and therefore God cannot change us. We are the extension of God. So we are God, actually, as the extension of God, Son of God. So God cannot stabilize hallucination for us, cannot make it permanent, cannot really do anything at all about it, except reassure us that hallucination doesn't change reality at all, and keep reminding us that the power we have of our mind, that we can set it down any instant we want. And keep reassuring us that he has not stabilized it for us, therefore we're free to drop it. As soon as you believe that God has somehow stabilized hallucination, then you feel you can't drop it. And then you feel you're bound, that you're a person, a human person in a world, and that's it. And then you're hoping for a nice afterlife or something, but it imprisons you. It is very imprisoning. Now, I say all this, of course, understanding that we all have insecurities about hearing this. I do too. You know, it's powerful medicine and it shakes us up, which is why I say when you're with an apex yogin, you're going to be like an earthquake has happened, an inner earthquake. You say, well, this is just like my whole, all of my insecurities seem to be shaking and falling down. Like, oh my gosh, I can't stabilize hallucination. Oh my gosh, that was the only hope I thought I had. And oh, but but then you just have to sit quiet and say, wow, this is great. Wow, just not even this is great. Just wow. Wow. And because it's very wowish. Don't accept it. Don't reject it. Don't accept it. Don't reject it. Don't accept it. Don't reject it. This is apex yoga, bro. Don't accept it. Don't reject it. Don't accept it. Don't reject it. Just like that. Don't accept it. Don't reject it. So I can sort of talk the mind stream of Longchenpa because I have this very, I'm very keen on crafting the expression of it, such that I keep wanting to make sure it's clear and smooth it out, clear, smooth it out, clear, smooth it out. Like because of my, history and in being really, really focused on this. I have an audience I'm trying to reach it, with music. I had an audience, and I said, I'm going to make sure that I convey, what I wanted to convey to the audience, and they can, they can digest it properly, and everything is, musicians love what they're playing. And that's conveyed to the audience too, that the musicians love the music they're playing. They're playing it really beautifully, and so if the musicians like it that are playing it, then the people audience is going to pick up on that. If the musicians don't like the music, then that will be conveyed to the audience. So I had to use musicians, the orchestra, as a medium. I had to go through them, so I had to make sure that I got it right. And I would, of course, I talked to musicians, and I showed them the score, and I'd say, what do you think? And they'd play it, and what do you think? And they'd give me feedback. I had, top musicians in Europe, and they'd tell me, they'd say, well, I'd change this part like this, because this is awkward, it's a little bit awkward. And so I'd take suggestions from different musicians, pianists and cellists and violinists and, various musicians on the parts, and then I'd go back and rescore it, and maybe this went on for years, and until finally, they'd say, ah, man, it's beautiful. I really want to play this. I'm really eager to play this because it's going to be fabulous. And then that would be transmitted to the audience because they love the music. They love the music. So, Longchenpa is very, wants me to really craft it properly. So I love what I'm saying. So the people will pick up on this. I really love this teaching. I really love this teaching. He's like the composer, and I'm like the, pianist or something who's says, well, playing it this way, I think maybe this, playing like this, the audience is, I feel more comfortable like saying it this way and this way. And he goes, oh yeah, okay, and like that. And that gets conveyed to you. Like, I'm really enthused by this. That gets conveyed to the audience. So I don't get stuck on stilted explanations. I don't. That's not me. Because of my history, I very much will rework stuff and transpose things in one way or the other, so it's suitable to those who are going to be utilizing it. Absolutely. Have to do that as a musician. You cannot just be some arrogant composer and say, look, this is how I wrote it. This is how you're going to play it. I was not that way at all. Man, if I felt it needed to be, tweaked, I would certainly tweak it. Because it's an invitation. There's different types of music. The more arrogant stuff is saying, okay, this is it, and you impose it upon the audience. And of course, some audiences want to be imposed upon. And I didn't want that kind of audience. I wanted an audience that was like an invitation. What's that? Are the mosquitoes already out? I hope not. It's an invitation to stop hallucinating the absence of God. An invitation. Not an imposition. And as such, you want the audience to be a little uncomfortable, like, wow, this is really amazing. This is really well crafted. Oh my gosh, I didn't expect this. This is more than I expected. And you want them to go through an experience, not an imposing experience, but a wow experience, a gentle wow experience. Like, my gosh, what a trip that was. Really shook me up. But it was still gentle. It was gentle, but I'm very shaken up by just hearing the tremendous confidence and subtlety and confidence there. That just seems like, wow, this music is just keeps going, and it's just all there in such a beautiful tapestry. Oh my gosh, it's so beautiful, the tapestry of it. And it hits hard. So, that's what I wanted to aim for that. And sensibilities of the time, sensibilities change. So, like listening to music, the music now, to me, it's not so good anymore. But back in the day, the sensibilities of people were such that they thought it was really terrific. But we demand more now. We demand more now. I realize that music can't, it's I've had enough of it. You can't. It goes so far. It goes so far, and then you really have to go further. Then you have to really develop skillful means and really aim for apex yoga. Aim for the apex. How are we doing here? Well, it's okay. Aim for the apex. I cannot edit it because it went over 1 hour. Oh well. Next time. Aim for the apex. Aim for the apex. Familiarity plays the decisive role. Keep that in mind. So, if you want to just keeps laboring on this, keeps laboring, and you're just a lifer, and you keeps, that will be decisive. It will be decisive because you will find yourself at some point, just suddenly it becomes something will become easy for you, that your whole life was blocked, and you just think, I don't know if I'll ever get this. I got to though, so I have to keep working, and one day it'll just snap, click into place, snap into place, and I just say, oh, that's it. Wow. Wow. And don't get fixated on your success. Just wow it. Don't fixate on it. Don't make anything of it, just accept wow. And you will discover, the lifers discover this, that they keep making these breakthroughs. They say, oh my gosh. And maybe a lot of them will come later in life as you've put all this momentum and pushed so much, is as you get near the apex viewpoint, that's when you really start just having so much insight and clarification. It's hard to keep up with it, and that's my problem right now. It's just very difficult. I don't know where I stand, and so it's very important when you practice to give up any sort of goal fixation at all. Don't try to measure. You're not trying to measure your progress at all, because the more you do that, the fact is you will make so much progress. It really is immeasurable. As if you have the goal of trying to measure your progress and be like an accountant and say, okay, how much progress did I make now? You will severely limit your progress. So don't ever try to determine how much progress you've made as you're practicing. You just keep practicing and just say, wow, I've got it. Wow, as if you've reached the conclusion that the presence of God, the peace of God rests upon you. Like, wow, the peace of God really is resting upon me now. Wow, and simulate that in your mind. Imagine that it was so. That it is so. This is the apex approach. Imagine that it is so. It's already so. And this is super great for really losing interest in doubt and hallucinating the absence of reality. It's super helpful. You lose interest in it by saying, oh my gosh, I'm already here. Therefore, I have to be interested in where I'm already at. I don't want to be bored or, so you really got to get with it if you're really already there. It's tremendous. It's tremendous. Tremendous practice. So successful. You don't dare trying to take the measure of it or do any accounting on it. Just have faith that this is more effective than you even realize. Way more effective. Apex practice is way more effective than we realize. So we say, wow, I'm already there. I've already succeeded. I see that the peace of God is resting upon everything. Oh my gosh, this is amazing. I'd made it. This is it. This is it. When I had it this Monday, I just kept saying, this is it. Wow, this is it. Wow, this is it. Wow, this is it. So, if that's the reaction we have to it, by saying, hey, this is it, that sort of reaction, it sort of induces what causes the reaction. It really does. Wow, this is it. So this is it. This is the peace of God. Wow, I made it. Wow, I really made it. It's like that. That's, again, very much apex yogan approach. I really did make it. Hallelujah. Imaho. Imaho. Like, how marvelous. What a marvelous blessing, you know. What an astonishingly marvelous blessing, imaho, in Tibetan. Wow. Like that. Wow. It's such a marvelous situation. All I can say is wow. You know, it's beyond marvelous. It's really beyond words. I made it. I really made it. I really did it. I did what I set out to do here. Practice that way. Practice that way. Apex yoga. You see, I am an apex yogin. Wow. In other words, I practice the wowish way, like by saying, I made it. I made it. Wow. So shocking. Wow. I did it. Against all odds, I did it. Against every sort of attempt at obstruction, I did it. It's done. I succeeded. I'm a victor. You know. I really am. I really am. Keep telling yourself, I really am. And keep believing it. Keep believing it. This is an extremely powerful, effective approach. Really, that sort of super positive optimism. Don't analyze the success. Do not analyze the success. That will severely block it. It's successful in every which way. It's totally successful. Wow, the practices really worked. They were totally successful. Tell yourself that. The practices were totally successful. Wow. Regrets gone, right? You succeeded. So don't try, that's a way better approach than trying to say, well, how do I get there? Refuse to do that. In the apex approach, we insist that we're already there. We're already there. Keep insisting on that. Now, some will take that as a practice, but to really practice it properly, you need to believe it. And so it's not really a practice. I mean, it's a reality for you. So your practice needs to have the feel. You need to feel like this is not even a practice. This has actually happened. This has really happened. Use your imagination like that, that this has actually happened. And so I'm just in the shock of success. So the way we really practice here is we really believe we're in the shock of success. Believing in the shock of success and then wowing that, wowing it. Don't take the measure of it. Don't analyze it. It's kind of weird here in California is... We had at least 5 straight years where there was no winter, hardly at all. I mean, really, it was like, it just, the beautiful days never stop. So, we're not used to coming out of a winter here. Really, we're not. We kind of had to hibernate for the last 3 months, actually, December, January, and February. in early March, and it's just raining all the time. So it's kind of like, wow, come back out and take a look at the sky, and the plants are here. It's weird. You have to get used to it. But it dries out fast here. The warm sun, and it's dry anyway, and boy, the water evaporates, and you can hardly tell it ever rained. It's not like a real humid or place where everything remains, kind of clammy and wet and moldy and mildewy and stuff. No, it's not like that here. It really, really seems dry and clear quite quickly, very quickly. And we're all weatherholics here. Most of us are really weatherholics. I certainly am. But the real weather you want, if you're a true weatherholic, you're looking for the perfect weather. I've always and that perfect weather is really, what is that weather? It's atmospheric ambience, right? It's the atmospheric ambience. And that's code word Hawaii. Well, the real greatest atmospheric ambience is the peace of God resting. Experience the peace of God resting upon everything. Everything's saturated in the peace of God. That's the ultimate atmospheric ambience. It's like pristine Molokai, the Hawaiian island. It's just, wow. Everything is just, almost pristine and untouched. Everything just seems so gently, graced. So, grace is so imperceptibly gentle and soft, and yet it's completely there. There's no way that perception itself can be so soft and gentle. So that's why I say it's imperceptibly soft and gentle. We can't see through perception, we can't see any mechanism for this. It's not possible. Perception itself being a mechanism, right? It's imperceptibly gentle and soft, the peace of God. Imperceptibly gentle and soft. I keep telling myself I'm going to diet, and I keep eating. Because you're working out, I feel like, wow, I need to, eat something. But not eating chocolate, which is very key. So that's good. Just keep sticking with it, and every day's a battle. And it should be that way in your life. Every day's a hassle. I mean, your habits hassle you, But you just get used to it, and you realize, wow, I gotta keep pushing here, because, I don't like to be hassled. It's, but you just have to tolerate it. Constantly, the world is inviting you back to into hell. Really, it says, come on back to what you're used to. Always, the world says that. Come on back to what you're used to. Whenever you feel that way, and everybody else is saying, "Oh, come on! I'm comfortable." Yeah, you seem uncomfortable. Come on back to what you where you're comfortable. That's a bad civilization. It does that. We're so comfortable with materiality now that everybody's just saying that. Come on back. I'm comfortable. I say, yeah, but look at how you're trending, and how it's going to end for you. That's no good at all. But they'll keep saying, "No, I'm fine. I'm comfortable." What they mean is they want to stay in the comfort zone of what they're used to, even if it's quote unquote killing them. They don't want to. They think it's easier. Well, in the short term, it may seem that way, but it's not just short term. It's where does that take you? And it gets really more and more and more and more problematical, more difficult. And so, it's and it doesn't come to any resolution at all. Again, you can't. We cannot secure ourselves from the instability of hallucination. We cannot isolate ourselves, separate ourselves from the insecurity of hallucination. It is impossible. We cannot separate ourselves from that. We can have multiple personalities. We can think we have a split mind. We can identify with bodies and all this. Doesn't do any good. Doesn't do any good. We think we found that special one that together now finally will be separate from and indemnify ourselves from, you know, hallucination, the insecurity of it, the vulnerability of it to simply changing our mind. And we hope, and ultimately we find out it didn't work. Then it's like crushing, you know, you thought you had the perfect situation, you found the perfect person, really means a perfect situation, and it turned out to be totally fraudulent, just like everything else, you know, has been. And so really, going through special relationships is hell. It really is, isn't it? It's really terrible. So much disillusionment and disappointment. Because we're asking the impossible of it. Deep down, we are, you know, and we're just so, says, well, I'll just stick it out, you know, just there's nothing I can do, it's not going to work. Torment. And when as soon as your attention shifts onto like an apex yoga, you have genuine hope, you know it works, and your torment's gone. As soon as it shifts back onto special relationships, the torment immediately appears again. Say, oh my gosh, I don't want, you know, how do I get out of this? Oh, it's horrible. So, people think their kids will do it for them. You know, what a terrible burden to put on your kids. Said, no, I had you kids so you would help, you know, stabilize hallucination for me. And if you don't do that, then you failed as my child. And we get this terrible guilt complex from our parents, don't we? And society in general, like, you failed us. Don't you fail us, you know, everybody else has failed, but I got faith in you. They tell us they have so much faith in us. I got so much faith that you are going to be able to stabilize hallucination for me. So I'm indemnified from it, from ever changing my mind. And they're putting an impossible burden on you. Totally impossible burden. Horrible, huh? So practice like saying, wow, it's finally worked. Wow, I finally got it. Wow, I finally got it. Now I've really got it. I finally really got it. And imagine this to be true. Okay, what time is it? We're going on. Whew. Okay, so I put a lot of effort into this one. Feeling a little run down now. I could catch another win, but, you know, it probably is enough is enough. This has really, you know, pushed us wonderfully. And familiarity is decisive. So just realize that. Some point, a lot of stuff will just click in place for you, and you just say, oh, it's easy. That's easy for me now. Never seems easy day by day, does it? But at some point, something will feel very easy for you. It's like, oh, that's not a problem anymore. Piece of cake for me. And then you'll go on to the stuff that's more difficult for you, but you'll just realize, oh, that's easy for me. It used to be difficult. Like learning to play the piano, the stuff you start out with, it seems very difficult, and you go through all sorts of difficulties, but the more progress you make, like the stuff you learned before, now it's easy for you, but you're still focused on stuff that's more difficult. until it's all easy. And you're not even worried about, is it easy or is it difficult? You're just like playing what you want to play, and just improvising and having fun, and you just feel like, there's nothing that's really too difficult here. I don't need to make it difficult for myself at all. The idea of how difficult can I make it for myself? No, I'm not really interested in that. I mean, how difficult can you make the impossible? It's kind of a ridiculous goal, isn't it? To see how difficult we can make the impossible. That's what we're trying to do, trying to make the impossible really difficult. Because that opens the door for that there's some area it's not impossible, right? It's just very difficult. So in other words, like stabilizing, we keep the stabilizing hallucination is not impossible, it's just really difficult. So we're really interested in great difficulty, because we're trying to substitute that for impossibility. It's a clever substitution we're trying to make. So we're really focused on great difficulty. Yeah, great difficulty stabilizing it, but it's not impossible, And once you realize it's impossible, what do you need great difficulty for? What do we need great difficulty for once we realize it's impossible? Don't need it at all, do we? We don't need any great difficulty anymore. And that's a whole different life, isn't it? It's like a rebirth, different purpose. So who knows what the spring is going to be like here in the world? And right, I don't have any plans or ideas or it's just open to the moment, open to the moment. No need to make it difficult. Maybe we'll just make it easy, right? Maybe we'll just make it really easy. It's possible, isn't it? Yeah. It'll just be this vast easement, this feeling of vast easement, like, oh my gosh, it's the spring of vast easement, the summer of smoothness. But yeah, maybe it's just like that. I don't know. I don't want, let's just look at spring. The spring of vast easement is a possibility. We see that this whole thing about difficulty was just ridiculous. Trying to make the impossible very difficult. That's pretty funny. So today I was laughing a lot because I was having all these insights, really, really clear insights, and it was quite funny how absurd we've been. The little clever little absurdist tricks, and then you see it, so that's the same trick. I mean, it's just ridiculous. And then, oh, I see it now. Yeah, it's always been that way. Ridiculous. Pretty funny. And at the same time, speed is of the essence. Make haste slowly, but certainly make haste. Torment is on the rise in the world. I mean, if you want to be tormented, this world's the place to be right now. So we better just be hassled by apex yoga instead of tormented by the world. Okay, this is the option you have. You're either going to be tormented by the world or be hassled by apex yoga. Apex yoga is like big wave territory. I was listening to an interview by a famous surfer, big wave surfer. I can't remember his name, Shane Dorian, it might be something like that. And then he talked about the contest, the big wave contest. And he was talking with another famous surfer, and he said, out there, the guys who win the contest are the ones who are the best hasslers, the most aggressive and best hasslers. And the guy who was interviewing him said, what? What are you talking about? He said, oh, yeah. He said, these guys know every trick in the book, man. They're very aggressive. They They play all these games. They paddle in front of you. They yell, I got it, this wave. They do everything they can to hassle with you and upset your rhythm and get you out of waves and trick you and all this stuff. It's really a lot of gamesmanship going on in the water out there. And the interviewer said, oh my gosh, he says, I thought it was all love and brotherhood out there. I thought it was all love and brotherhood out there. And you're telling me, and the guy says, ah, oh, just the opposite. No way. No way is it that way. It's like burst this bubble. It's like, oh my gosh, I thought you're all like, hey, bro, how you doing? Love being out here with you. He said, no, it's really a jungle there. Everybody's trying to get over on you. He said, I don't really like that. All I'm looking for is just one beautiful wave so I can remember it. I'm not really into all this, competitive sort of stuff. But he was good-natured about it. Said, that's just the way it is. So in the big wave environment of Apex Yoga, you're just going to feel like your insecurities are going to hassle you. Absolutely, they will. Absolutely, they will. But just be glad that you're not in the swamp of being tormented by the world. I'm not really tormented by the world anymore. I'm hassled by Apex Yoga, which is great. So that's the choice really we have. Just realize this is the choice you have, really. Pragmatically, that's the only choice you have. Either you're going to be tormented by the world or hassled by Apex Yoga. That's it. And keep in mind, all the beautiful people in the 60s and stuff, they didn't make it through the 60s as beautiful people, really. If you followed, I mean, we followed. I mean, the whole pop culture, all the icons and everything. We followed them in magazines and radio. I mean, they were our culture. So I followed all this stuff, and was very up on all of it. And the counterculture was our culture, 60s pop counterculture. They didn't do so well. Okay, nobody did well. Ultimately, everybody had a rough go. The world ended up tormenting them. It really did. I bet you still got Crazy George, banging his drum, and you got Wavy Gravy still making bubbles. But they're tormented souls. They're fixated, tormented souls. At least that's how I see them. They didn't make it through. They didn't make it through. Did Timothy Leary make it through? No. Ram Dass, he's got a, he is what he is. But did he make it through? I don't, I, for me, no. He's sort of the portrayed like, I'll make it, this is how you make it through. It wasn't actually how you make it through. So that was his role, sort of to help encourage people. Said, no, you're going to make it through this way. The way we're doing, you'll get make it through. And nobody made it through. He didn't even make it through. That's my honest appraisal. So I realized that. I said, nobody's making it through. This isn't good. This is not my destiny. I'm not going to follow these leaders. Actually, I didn't really follow them. I was aware of them, but I said that this is not looking good. It's not looking promising. This is what I was warned about. They're trying to make the impossible just difficult, really difficult, and then call that good. That gives you some sort of false enlightenment perspective, like there is some way to stabilize hallucination. It's just really difficult. There is some hope that we can do it. And then they play a role that like that. Yeah, I'm in touch with it. I'm in touch with it. Or it's some posturing. It's some role playing. It's the baby boomers were good at it. They're really good at it. Very confident, overconfident. Especially the one from back east. Very confident, overconfident. Brooklynite, so to speak. And so that's what it was. And I said, ah, man, that's just not going to work. And it didn't. It didn't. It didn't. It didn't work. But some of us seem to be hanging in there and still working on it really, really, really intensely. Really, that's great to see. If I see anyone like my age still working on it intensely, that's awesome. That's really awesome. Because we realize, hey, we haven't made it. I mean, we're still working on it intensely here. With a lot of hindsight, which is powerful leverage. Have I made it? Well, according to Longchenpa, I have. He said it's a fait accompli. But from my perspective, I practice. Like, yeah, wow, I finally made it. But it's a practice. But it's a belief that helps induce it. It helps familiarity issue. Helps evaporate the familiarity issue. So the way I practice is I practice. Like, yeah, I have made it. I finally made it. To get my whole nerves, my whole psyche, my expectations, acclimatized to this. And when my expectations are all there, then I'll just click into place. And that's it. But you have to work from the angle of expectations and familiarity. Have to work from that angle. Don't keep your expectations the same way until it hits you and then say, oh my gosh, now I need to adjust. Adjust your expectations as if for sure you're going to succeed. In fact, you already have succeeded. So how do I feel now that I've succeeded? Keep the expectations in front of you at all times that you're working on your expectations, reshaping your expectations, because that's what controls us, our expectations. It controls our experiencing at this point. It really does. It really does. So in my life, I've always felt like for sure I'm going to make it. For sure I'm going to make it. It's no doubt about it. So this really helps with expectations if you have this attitude. In fact, every day I expect this is today's the day I'm going to make it finally. Always had that. And this is, super helpful in reshaping the whole gamut of your expectations. And there's a big gamut of them for sure. Massive amount of expectations we have for how is our experiencing going to go? How is it going to flow? We have all these expectations, like, riverbed channels, like carving through the Grand Canyon. We think, this is how this is going to go through the Grand Canyon. And it's carved so deep. How do you change the course of a river in the Grand Canyon? You think it's almost impossible, right? Just release everything exactly as it is, this moment, and it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter at all, where the river flows, where it doesn't flow. It's all saturated with the peace of God. So in other words, you see the apex perspective. Imagine you see already see it. That's the apex perspective. Changes everything. One insight settles it all. One insight settles it all. That's apex yoga. One insight settles it all, and you could say, I have that insight. I already have it. I'm experiencing this insight and it's settled it all. I am experiencing this insight and it has settled it all. Now don't look for the insight because you say, I've already got it, so I don't need to look for it. I've already got it and everything is settled. That's it. I'm finished. So keep on rehearsing as though you have truly finished. Otherwise, our expectations will keep us plodding along and spinning us off into side trips. Says, whoa, you can't finish yet because you don't expect to. So let's delay you a little longer. Okay? If we don't expect to finish, we're sure not going to finish. We'll always throw something in our way, in front of us. Like, oh, there's another something else to tackle. We always will. But if our expectations are that we truly have already finished, it's already done, finished, then we won't throw anything else in our way. We won't obstruct ourselves anymore. This is the apex approach. This is the genius approach of Longchenpa. And the apex array. Now, when our expectations are affected like this, it shocks us, and we go through this wow phase of the practice. It's very important. It really gives us kind of the jitters for a while. because we don't know exactly what to expect, because our new expectations haven't quite taken hold, but the old ones have crumbled. So you go through this kind of a no man's land of some jitters for a while. And so we just say, wow, okay, I'm in the wow. That's easy. It's no problem. Just stay in the wow. Don't expect anything out of it for a little while, right? Because it's a transitional feeling you're having, a transitional feeling. Transitioning from doubt to certainty. Transitional feeling of wow. So the wow is this bridge, a transitional feeling that we have. It's just a label. You know, we feel a certain way, but we just use one label for it. Just wow. Don't get caught up in the play of labels. Refuse. Just one word, wow. That's it. No other play of labels. The more you use this word wow, the easier it's going to go for you, as you just lose interest in all labels altogether, actually. Wow is the final label that you use. You realize, wow, I have one final label I'm going to use, and it's just wow. That's it. And rehearse that too. I have one final label that I use and no others, and just wow. And that's it. And just abide in the wow without any other labels or even thought of any other label. Another powerful apex yogin approach. I am an apex yogin. Wow. And you can see there's a lot to wow about. It's very wowish. The whole approach is wowish. And nothing other than that, really. Okay, how are we doing? Very good. Very great. Just see how it goes. I'm wowed right now. And tomorrow's another day, isn't it? I'm not going to think about that. I still have more help I can give the world tonight after this video. I'll try and do some more work, and I just try every day. I try to produce as much for everyone as possible, because again, we can either be tormented by the world or hassled by apex yoga. And so take up the hassle of it. Take up the hassle of big wave riding. What's the biggest, best big wave in the world? The answer is Piahi. I think that's in Maui, actually. Jaws is called Jaws. And I think Shane Dorian said, they asked him that. I said, well, he says, just on an average day at Jaws, it's still better than any other big wave in the world. It's that good. And when it's good, it's insanely good. And I've seen a lot of rides at OPI, and I have to say, I agree. I mean, just watching it, I said, man, there's just nothing better than watching someone surfing Jaws. I mean, it's the best. I think what Albie Layer goes out there a lot. There's certain guys who really, like no locals there, that just, I mean, they just live to surf Jaws. That's pretty much it. And the thing about Jaws is what makes it so great is it's a big wave that you can carve on. Okay, you can carve all sorts of turns and stuff, get barreled, deeply barreled and carved, but it's a massive wave. Other big waves like Waimea and Mavericks, you can't do that really. You can't carve. Or Nazare, not really like Jaws. No, you can't. It's more like a massive mountain moving, and you're kind of skiing down a slope, and you're just trying to get to the shoulder and survive and stuff. But not Jaws. I mean, it's Chapu in Tahiti. You're just trying to get in the barrel and survive it, mostly, really. But Jaws, you can really, do turns on and position yourself, and like it's a smaller wave, except it's massive. And of course, any mistake you make is pretty dangerous. So he said, yeah, no, hands down, best big wave in the world. Nothing's even close, really. It is no doubt about it. Pretty cool to hear that. So we're like, surfers at Jaws. We're like locals at Jaws. We're like that. You need to get that feeling. I'm a local here, and I surf, the best big wave on the planet. I'm surfing this, apex yoga is my wave. I'm a big wave rider. But I'm surfing it like it was a smaller wave. I'm not just this charger that just, am I gonna get killed? No, I keep going. But I'm really seeing the possibilities of the wave and wow, to see those guys carve it up, it's really amazingly impressive. And they paddle into it. He told me something very interesting, that it used to be everybody was towed into this wave. It was deemed unpaddable. Unpaddleable. That's very difficult to say. Unpaddleable. And so they were using jet skis to tow the surfers into to catch it. And he was like one of the first people to start paddling to catch it. And he was asked, like, what happened? There's no more towing in at Jaws at all anymore. And he said, was some law was passed? What happened? The state mandated or somebody mandated? What happened? He said, no, nothing happened. It's just a group of us locals, me and some younger guys, just went out and we started trying to paddle it. And gradually we won the respect of all the tow, tow skier, tow surfers, towed in surfers. And they started saying, hey, take the wave, go ahead. Because they started respecting what we were doing so much. And then gradually it just became uncool to tow and surf Jaws. And now he says, if anybody tow and surfs Jaws when other surfers are out paddling, it's totally uncool. Totally uncool. Amazing. Without any laws being passed at all, the whole culture just flipped because he and a number of young locals went out and started paddling into the wave. It was deemed to be too dangerous and too difficult and, really. But now everybody paddles into it. That's really quite extraordinary. But, the ass, some of the, what's the worst wipeout you had? Well, some of the people say, well, Jaws, I mean, you can get some heavy wipeouts there and some massive sets in El Nino of 2016, winter of 2015, 2016. Jaws was just massive and it was incredible. And there's a story there of guys surfing it. It was so huge. It was just so scary huge. They finally paddled in after the day and a lot of people barely survived it. Nobody died, but a lot of people, really got beat up and some almost died. And they're finally sitting on the cliff. Everyone's safe. And they say, oh my gosh, we all survived. Nobody died. And then it was like just towards sunset and everybody was in and they looked out. And there was this like absolutely the wave of all waves, like a 100-foot wave at Jaws. It would have just absolutely crushed everyone. Just, some freak anomaly massive wave. And that they were all in on the cliff at this point. And they just watched it. And they said, just watching that wave, it just blew their minds, completely blew their minds. But they said they were all glad they weren't riding that wave. They weren't out there at that point because they might have, they were being cleaned up by that wave for sure. Or if they'd have been far enough out, they said, "Well, I gotta try to catch this wave." They said, "No." That's a little too much. Pretty, very amazing story. Nazaré is the place right now in Portugal because you can watch it. You're so close to the action. You're up on this point, this lighthouse point kind of thing, right on this cliff right above it. And you can really see it so close. The action is so close. And it's just unbelievably scary. It's the greatest show in the ocean right now, is watching the big swells in Nazaré, Portugal. Yeah. And he said, that's probably going to be the spot in the next 10 years. It's more and more surfers are going to go there and try to, try to master it. It's going to be the big challenge in the world. Interesting. And others say it's too difficult, too difficult. So, again, but for us, we can say, you know what? We'll hang out at Jaws, Piahi Maui, and we'll surf Piahi Jaws and get really good at it. Get really good at it. Learn the wave, learn the channel, learn how it works, how the swell is and the tides and what you can make and what you can't. And you just have to get really familiar with the wave and how it is. And then you could get really familiar with the wave and then you could ride it. That's called locals. Locals can handle their waves. You go out with locals of the place and they're gonna really show you, this is how you surf this wave, and they know it. They know how to surf it. All the little intricacies of it, they learn it. And what to look out for, what to avoid, when to go, when not to go. So, yeah. So we're just hanging out here, and at Apex, we're surfing Apex. We're Apex surfers, actually. Or apex surfers. How can I look like an apex surfer? I don't know. What's the surf look? Have to get an Apex. Maybe this shirt is like an Apex surf look. Look, maybe this is a little Apex surf look, like the hat and the shirt. Possible. Yeah. Okay. Lots of little bugs are starting to fly around. I see little bugs kind of. They'll be coming out of the woodwork soon, right? So again, I. It's auspicious time. It's an auspicious time, but I've had many, my whole life has been an auspicious time. So it doesn't necessarily mean anything. But like this morning, like my meditation, I was aware, it was astonishing. I couldn't stop the visual imagery. And it just kept shifting and shifting. Every time I try to focus on change, on getting free of it, it would suddenly shift on me. Pretty interesting, huh? So that was the defense my mind is using. Every time I became aware of a whole visual scenario that was consuming my mind. I said, oh my gosh, that's just a visual scenario. Full stop on the wow, I'm an Apex Yoga and wow. As soon as I became aware of that, it anticipated it, and my mind would completely shift scenarios into some completely different scenario with all the visuals and the whole melodrama of it. I said, oh my gosh, okay. And then it would shift again. And it just kept shifting like this. I said, God help, I don't know how to handle this. I don't know how to handle it. I'm still not sure how to handle it. I really was praying for help. So that's a tricky one. I'm in trouble with that. Is it just immediate, as if somehow this other scenario is completely different? I could say the peace of God is upon this too, and just have no interest in labels. It's just another set of labels, is all. Labeling. Impossibility. Peace of God is upon all these labels equally. So it doesn't really matter. So I have to do something like that. So the mind keeps playing tricks on you, and the creativity is astonishing. How a complete new scenario, like a whole different world, would just arise in my mind. I would present it like I was in that, a whole, but the people, situations, everything. And just immediately shift onto it. And the other one was abandoned, which. It's like a false meditation. I had abandoned the other scenarios if I made progress, and yet I had shifted into simply another scenario, out of the frying pan into the fire. And kept doing that as if, yeah, okay, I've got it. Like the ego saying, okay, I understand how to meditate. You want to abandon what you came rose before. I said, no. I just want to not get fixated on anything. I don't want to get unfixated on one thing only to fixate on some other scenario. That's not what I'm doing at all. So once again, ego has the wrong approach. The wrong approach. So don't be pro or con any scenario that arises. And the ego says, oh, you want me to go back to the other approach? Just say, well, makes no difference at all. Just I'm an Apex Yoga and wow, I'm experiencing the peace of God. I'm already experiencing the peace of God. It's too late for all these scenarios. It's too late for them. So I'm not interested in them. When it's too late for something, why should we be interested in it? Interest is gone. Interest is gone. I already have the peace of God. I'm not interested in, what did I get rid of? I already have it. So now I'm experiencing it. It's like that. What did I get rid of? How did my meditation succeed? That's water under a bridge at this point. So the ego say, well, maybe it was this. Maybe it was this. Maybe you got rid of this. Maybe.